Assalamu alaikum students. Our today's topic is oral cavity and we will discuss the pharynx. The learning objectives of the today's class are, you should be able to describe the structure of the oral cavity, divide pharynx into its subdivisions, describe the structure of each division of the pharynx, describe the muscles of the pharynx with regard to attachment, innervation and action, and discuss the applied aspects of the pharynx. This is the oral cavity and it is divisible into two parts, oral vestibule between the lips and the cheek and the gum and the alveoli. Oral cavity proper, which is between the cavity between the mandible and the maxillary arch. Oral vestibule, it is bounded anteriorly by the lips, laterally by the cheeks, superior by the mucolabial and buccolabial folds, posteriorly immediately by the gum and the teeth. Oral cavity proper, within the alveolar margins of the maxillary and the mandible. It has a roof which is formed anteriorly by the hard plate and posteriorly by the soft plate, and the floor is formed by the mylohyoid muscle, and in it lies the tongue. This is the floor of the mouth. It is covered by mucous membrane, which is of stratified squamous, non-keratinized type of epithelium. The undersurface of the tongue is connected to the floor of the mouth by a fold of mucous membrane, what is called a frenulum. Lower down, there is a papilla on either side of the frenulum, on the summit of which opens the submandibular salivary gland. From these, on either side, there is a ridge of rounded ridge, which is produced by the sublingual salivary gland, and on its summit, the sublingual duct is open. Coming to the pharynx, what is pharynx? Pharynx is a fibromuscular funnel-shaped tube which carries food and air towards the esophagus and the larynx. It is dimensionless, it has length of 12 cm, width at the upper part is 3.5 cm, and as it goes downwards, it narrows down. The lower part is narrowest with 1.5 cm. Function of the pharynx, upper part of the pharynx carries on the air, the middle part carries both air and the food, and the lower part carries the only food. Boundaries of the pharynx, superiorly we have the base of the skull, along with the basis saphenoid and basis occipital bones. Inferiorly we have the esophagus at 6 cervical vertebra. Anteriorly, we have there the postnasal apertures. Posteriorly, there is the arch of the atlas. And laterally, there is tubal opening, tubal elevation, which lie on the lateral aspect. This is the diagram of the different divisions of the pharynx. So the pharynx is present as arteriary tubes, openings of the arteriary tubes, two posterior nares, larynx and esophagus. It also contains tonsils, pharyngeal tonsil, palatine tonsil, lingual tonsil and tubal tonsil. If you see the structure of the pharyngeal wall, from within outwards we have the mucosa. The mucosa is stratified squamous or keratinized type of epithelium. And the submucosa is a loose connective tissue which contains the tonsils in it, the lymphoid aggregation. Then there lies the inside the submucosa, there is pharyngeal aponeurosis, or what we call a pharyngobasal fascia. Then outer with this pharyngeal aponeurosis, there lies the muscular coat which consists of outer circular layer and the inner longitudinal layer. The circular layer comprises of the constrictors and the inner longitudinal layer consists of longitudinal muscles. Outside that is the buccopharyngeal fascia. The buccopharyngeal fascia and the muscular pharyngobasal fascia, pharyngeal aponeurosis, and the buccopharyngeal fascia, they enclose the muscular cord. For discrete purposes, we develop the pharynx into three parts: nasopharynx, oropharynx, and the laryngopharynx. So this is the nasopharynx, this is the oropharynx, and this is the laryngopharynx. Coming to the nasopharynx, which is also called as epipharynx. This is the diagram of the nasopharynx. So these are the various structures in the epipharynx or the nasopharynx. So it has a nasal part of the pharynx, and it resembles nose structurally and functionally. Like that, it is structurally, it has the epithelium, which is pseudostratified columnar epithelium, and it carries air in it. Like the nose, it has the stout walls for support. On its lateral walls, there lie some structures, like there are two openings of the auditory tube. On the auditory tube, its margin is elevated, what we call as tubal elevation or tubus torus tuberis. This elevation is produced because of tubal tonsil. So under this elevation, there lies the collection of lymphoid tissue, what we call as tubal tonsil. This elevation goes downwards as salpingopharyngeal fold. This salpingopharyngeal fold contains under it a muscle, salpingopharyngeus muscle. It communicates with the oropharynx. It communicates with the oropharynx with the nasopharyngeal isthmus. So this nasopharyngeal isthmus is bound by the soft palate and by the dorsum of the nasopharynx. On the posterior wall are the pharyngeal posterior, there is the nasopharyngeal tonsil, or simply pharyngeal tonsil, which is a collection of lymphoid tissue in the submucosa, and we call it as adenoids. Sometimes there is what is called as nasopharyngeal bursa, which is actually pouch of Lushka, which is a remnant of anterior end of the notochord. Similarly, there can be Rutke's pouch. So that is again a recess because of the reminiscent of the buccal mucosal evagination. When it forms the anterior lobe of the pituitary gland, it remains there as a recess, what we call as Rutke's pouch. There is also fossa of Rosenmüller or later pharyngeal recess, which is just lateral to the tubal elevation, and sometimes there it lodges the malignancy. So this is the tubal opening, is the tubal elevation, and lateral to it lies the fossa of Rosenmüller. Under the applied aspects of the nasopharynx, so I told you in the superior wall of the nasopharynx, there lies the adenoids. Nasopharyngeal adenoids, nasopharyngeal tonsil, or what is called as adenoids. In children, this may sometimes increase in size, and it will press the short palate, and so there will occur obstruction to the airflow from the nose down to the nasopharynx. So the child has obstruction of air passage, so the child starts breathing through oral cavity. So the child has oral breathing. Simultaneously, some other features develop in the child. There can be also what we call a craniopharyngioma in the Rottkis pouch, because there is the remnant of the epithelial tissue that may give craniopharyngioma. Coming to the oropharynx. So this is the oropharynx here. Oropharynx. It is also called as mesopharynx. And it lies behind the cervical. It is bounded behind by the cerebral vertebrae C2 and C3 and contents of the retropharyngeal space. C2 and C3 and the contents of the retropharyngeal space. In front, it communicates with the oral cavity. In front, it communicates with the through oropharyngeal isthmus. Oropharyngeal isthmus here. And here it is bounded, this oropharyngeal isthmus is by short palate and posterior aspect of the tongue. Below, it communicates with the laryngopharynx at the level of upper border of the epiglottis. On the lateral wall of the oropharynx, there lies collection of lymphoid tissue, what we call as palatine tonsil. So palatine tonsil, an oval structure present in the tonsillar fossa. So mass of oval lymphoid tissue present in the tonsillar fossa is called as tonsil or palatine tonsil. This palatine tonsil, it has two surfaces, medial and lateral. Two poles, upper and lower. Coming to the medial surface of the tonsil. The medial surface of the tonsil has the lining epithelium, which is stratified squamous, non-keratinized type of epithelium. And this epithelium dips inside the parenchyma of the tonsil in the form of crypts. There are some 12 to 15 primary crypts, which divide into secondary crypts. One of the crypts anteriorly there is very large, that is called as crypta magna. That is actually the ventral aspect of the second pharyngeal pouch. The crypts may be filled with fecal material, epithelial debris, food particles, and bacteria, which may result in foul breath to the person. Coming to the lateral surface of the tonsil. Laterally, the tonsil has a very well-developed fibrous capsule. Underneath the fibrous capsule, there lies that tonsillar bed. The tonsillar bed is separated from the fibrous capsule by loose areolar tissue. This loose areolar tissue help us in dissection of the tonsil out when we perform tonsillectomy. So that time this loose areolar tissue help us in easily taking the tonsil out. But sometimes if there is infection in the tonsil, there may be occur collection in this loose areolar tissue, what we call as peritonsillar abscess or Quincy. Coming to the tonsillar bed, two muscles are there, superior constrictor muscle and the styloglossus muscle. Styloglossus and the superior constrictor muscle. In addition, there are structures which are related to the tonsillar bed. They are striatal process, glossopharyngeal nerve, facial artery, submandibular salivary gland, posterior belly of the digastric, medial pterygoid muscle, and angle of the mandible. These are the structures in the tonsillar bed. Coming to the upper pole. This upper pole extends to the soft palate. There is a semilunar fold of mucous membrane which extends superiorly and encloses a space there, what we call a supratonsillar fossa. Coming to the lower pole. The lower pole is attached to the tongue. Again, there is a triangular fold of mucous membrane called and which encloses a space called anterior tonsillar space. Also, there is a sulcus, what is called tonsillar lingual sulcus, between the lower pole and the tongue. Sometimes this sulcus may lodge carcinoma there. Bullets of the tongue. Branches of the external carotid artery supply the tonsil. The branches are the tonsil branch of the facial artery, which is a tonsil branch of the facial artery, which is a main artery. Then we have the ascending palatine branch of the facial artery, ascending pharyngeal branch of the external carotid artery, and dorsal lingual branch of the lingual artery, and descending palatine branch of the maxillary artery. So main branch is the tonsil branch of the facial artery. Venous drainage, the paratonsil vein, which in turn drains into the common facial vein and pharyngeal venous plexus. The lymphatic drainage, the lympheticus pierces the superior constrictor muscle and reaches to the upper cervical nodes, especially the jugulodigastric node. This jugulodigastric node becomes commonly inflamed when there is recurrent tonsillitis. And enlarged non-tender jugulodigastric lymph node is a sign of chronic tonsillitis. Coming to the nerve supply of the tonsil, it is supplied by lesser palatine branch of the saphenopalatine ganglion and glossopharyngeal nerve. Functions of the tonsils, protective. As it is a lymphoid tissue, it protects against any pathogen which enters through the respiratory passage or oral passage. There are crypts which actually increase the surface area of the tonsil. And this tonsil, palatine tonsil, forms the part of Valdeir's ring. Applied aspects. As I told you, the tonsil, it prevents the infection from entering the respiratory or the digestive system. But it can act as a septic focus for recurrent infection of the tonsil causing and other structures. It can cause chronic tonsillitis. There can, during surgery, the paratonsillar vein may get ruptured and cause severe hemorrhage. If there is a damage to glossopharyngeal nerve, that may lead to the loss of taste sensation. Tonsillar pain may be referred to the middle ear because of similar nerve supply. We have different tonsils in the pharynx. We have pharyngeal tonsil, what we also call adenoids, palatine tonsil, lingual tonsil, and tubal tonsil. These all tonsils, so we have the nasopharyngeal tonsil, tubal tonsil, palatine tonsil, and the lingual tonsil. So these tonsils form a ring around the entrance of the respiratory and oral passage, what we call as Valdeir's ring. So this is the Valdeir's ring, posterior one third of the tongue, lingual tonsil, tubal tonsil, palatine tonsil, and nasopharyngeal tonsil. Coming to the laryngopharynx. So the laryngopharynx lies below the oropharynx. It is also called as hypopharynx. It lies behind the larynx. So this is the larynx, and behind it is the laryngopharynx. It extends from the upper border of the epiglottis to the lower border of the cricoid cartilage. Anterior wall, there is the inlet of the larynx and posterior surface of the cricoid and the arytenoid cartilages. Posterior wall, there is fourth and fifth cervical vertebrae, and it also includes lower part of the third and upper part of the sixth cervical vertebrae. In addition, posteriorly, there are the three constrictor muscles. Lateral wall, on either side of the epiglottis, there lies the piriform fossa. A depression there. This is bounded medially by the periepiglottic fold and laterally by the thyroid cartilage and thyroid membrane. Beneath the mucosa of the fossa, there lies the internal laryngeal nerve. And in this fossa, commonly foreign body gets, in the piriform fossa, foreign body gets lodged. And then we have to remove that foreign body. We have to take care that we will not damage the internal laryngeal nerve which lies underneath it. If there is a damage to the internal laryngeal nerve, there can be loss to the sensation in the supraglottic region of the larynx, because it supplies the supraglottic region of the glottis. And when there is loss of sensation, then can be aspiration and the person may die of pneumonia. Coming to the muscles of the pharynx, we have the muscular coat, which is wedged between the pharyngeal aponeurosis and buccopharyngeal fascia. It comprises of muscles, outer circular layer, superior constrictor, middle constrictor, and inferior constrictor. And in the longitudinal layer, we have stylopharynges, sulpingopharynges, and palatopharynges. So these are the muscles of the pharynx, superior constrictor, middle constrictor, and the inferior constrictor. Superior constrictor muscle. So superior constrictor muscle, it originates from the posterior border of the medial pterygoid palate and pterygoid hamulus and pterygopandibular raphe and posterior end of the myelohyoid line of the mandible. And it gets inserted over the pharyngeal tubercle. It is supplied by pharyngeal plexus of nerve and it constricts the pharynx to propel its contents. Middle constrictor originates from the stylohyoid ligament and lesser cornu of the hyoid bone and upper part of the greater cornu of the hyoid bone and gets inserted in the pharyngeal raphe. Nerve supply is supplied by pharyngeal plexus of nervus. Action, again, it constricts the contents in it. Inferior constrictor. The inferior constrictor muscle, it has two parts, thyropharynges and cricopharynges. The thyropharynges originates from oblique line of the thyroid cartilage and tendinous band across the cricoid muscle. And the cricopharyngeal part originates from the cricoid cartilage. Both parts get inserted into the pharyngeal raphe. And it is supplied by pharyngeal plexus as the other two constrictors. In addition, it is supplied by external laryngeal nerve and recurrent laryngeal nerve. And as it is composed of two parts, structurally it is similar muscle, but functionally, physiologically, they are acting as two muscles. The thyropharyngeal muscle, its fibers are downward and obliquely placed, whereas the cricopharyngeal muscle, its muscle fibers are horizontally placed. When thyropharyngeal muscle contracts, the cricopharyngeal has to relax to propel the contents in the esophagus. So these two muscles, their action is opposed to each other. Coming to stylopharyngeal muscle. Stylopharyngeal muscle, it originates from the medial surface of the stylohyoid process and enters the pharynx in between the superior and the middle constrictor muscles and gets inserted in the posterior border of the lamina of the thyroid cartilage and lateral aspect of the epiglottis. It is supplied by glossopharyngeal nerve. So only muscle in the pharynx and muscle supplied by the glossopharyngeal nerve. Stylopharyngeal muscle is the only muscle which is supplied by glossopharyngeal nerve. All other muscles are supplied by the vagoaxillary complex or the pharyngeal plexus of the nerves. Action, it elevates the pharynx. Palatopharynges, it originates from the posterior border of the hard plate and gets inserted along with the stylopharynges into the thyroid cartilage. Nerve supply is supplied by the pharyngeal plexus. Action, it elevates forwards and medially the pharynx. Sulpingopharynges, it originates from the cortex of the artery tube because it's close to the artery opening, and from the cartilage there arise the sulpingopharyngeal muscle. and it raise a fold on the surface of the pharynx, what we call as salpingeal fold. And it gets inserted, it blends with the palatopharyngeal muscle and gets attached to the posterior border of the thyroid cartilage. It is supplied by pharyngeal plexus nervus, and action during swallowing, it helps us in opening of the auditory tube so as to balance the air in the middle ear. What is Killian's distance? As I told you, we have two parts of the inferior constrictor, thyropharynges and cricopharynges. Their action is opposite to each other. There is a weakness, triangular weakness, what is called as Killian's dehiscence. If there is incoordination of the thyropharyngeal muscle and cricopharyngeal muscle, when the thyropharyngeal muscle propels its contents, cricopharyngeal muscle does not relax to receive the contents. There occurs this weakness may bulge outwards in the form of a diverticulum, what we call as Zenker's diverticulum. So we have this as the Zenker's diverticulum. So Killian's dehiscence is a weakness between the cricopharynges and thyropharynges. And if there is incoordination of the movement of the these two muscles, there can occur a diverticulum, what we call as Zenker's diverticulum. Also, this Killian's dehiscence, it is a weak spot and it may result in perforation during esophagoscopy. Coming to the structures between the constrictors. Between the base of the skull and the superior constrictor, what is also called as space of Morgagni, we have their auditory tube, tensor, and levator valley palatae muscles. Between the superior constrictor and middle constrictor, we have the stellopharynges and the glossopharyngeal nerve. Between the middle constrictor and inferior constrictor muscle, we have the superior laryngeal nerve and vessels. Between the inferior constrictor and the esophagus, we have the recurrent laryngeal nerve and the inferior laryngeal vessels. Coming to the blood supply of the pharynx, we have the ascending pharyngeal branches of the external carotid artery, ascending palatine and tonsil branches of the facial artery, and dorsal lingual branches of the lingual, greater palatine, pharyngeal, and pterygoid branches of the maxillary artery. Coming to the venous drainage of the pharynx, venous form of plexus on the posterior lateral aspect of the pharynx. It receives blood from the pharynx, short palate, and prevertebral region. It communicates with the plexus above and drains into the internal jugular vein and facial vein. Coming to the lymphatic drainage, the retropharyngeal group of lymph nodes and in the deep cervical lymph nodes go to the lymphatics. Nerve supply, pharyngeal plexus. This plexus forms the pharyngeal branch of the vagus, which is motor. Pharyngeal branch of the ninth, that is glossopharyngeal nerve, that is sensory, and also superior cervical sympathetic ganglion. Thank you.